Hey everyone, and welcome to another video filmed right here in my living room, because today I'm going to talk about yet another OLED TV from LG. Now, it's not a secret that I'm an absolute fan of OLED technology, and I still very firmly believe that once you experience an OLED TV, there is definitely no chance you will ever settle for anything less than that. They offer the best picture quality you can get from a TV, they offer fantastic infinite contrast, beautiful vibrant colors, and a great HDR experience, and nowadays they don't even cost that much more than a traditional TV, so they're definitely more mainstream now than they were when I bought my first one about four-ish years ago. So, I had a 55-inch LG C7 for a couple of years, and then last year I upgraded it with a 65-inch LG G10, and I've been very happy with both so far. But this year, LG is launching a brand new model, and the G10 I had is now being replaced with the G1 that's currently hanging behind me. This G1 is not just supposed to be better, but they actually claim they made big improvements with the whole OLED technology, and they're even calling it OLED Evo or OLED 2.0. Obviously, replacing a one-year-old OLED TV with a brand new model is just really difficult to financially justify, but fortunately, LG was kind enough to just send me one of these to test and to review, so let's check it out. This video is brought to you by Corsair and their K60 RGB Pro. This affordable mechanical keyboard comes with Cherry's brand new super smooth Viola switches, a nice aluminum finish, and of course, a bunch of RGB. Check it out using the links in the description below. Just like before, next to the G series, there will be a more mainstream C series available as well. Now, the G stands for gallery. It is extremely thin and elegant, and it is meant to be wall mounted, so it doesn't come with a stand, it only comes with a wall mount. Well, the more standard C series is a bit thicker, comes with a stand by default, and it is meant to primarily sit on a TV cabinet. And up until now, both G and C models had the same panel, but different designs. While this year, they kind of decided to spice things up a bit, so only the G series has the new OLED Evo panel, while the C series has a more standard one. So unfortunately, whatever is in this review will not apply to the C1, as the panel is actually different. Now, when it comes to size, you can choose between a 55-inch, 65-inch, and a 77-inch TV, with a 65-inch being the sweet spot, in my opinion. And as I said before, it doesn't come with a stand, but a special wall mount where the TV ends up completely snug against the wall. I mean, it just looks really elegant, like a painting in a way, and even though the C7 was not that thick to begin with, it just feels bulky in comparison to this one. Now, the mounting mechanism is exactly the same as on the last year's model, so if you're crazy enough to buy a new TV every year, you can just leave the old mounting in place. But if this is your first one, you don't have to worry, because it is very easy to hang it up as long as you have another person helping out, because it is actually surprisingly heavy for such a thin TV. So all you have to do is screw the mounting plate into the wall, hang the TV in it, lock it in, and push it snug against the wall. Now, they still include that silly paper that you can stick to the wall to guide you, but as I said before, it is actually impossible to make it stand straight with all the folds, so I would skip that step and just do the traditional measuring and leveling. And even if the plate isn't perfectly straight on the wall, you can easily completely adjust the TV after you hang it, which is incredibly useful, and I kind of wish they mentioned that a bit earlier in the instructions rather than after completely stressing out while trying to make the bracket perfectly straight. Even though you can always pull the TV out a bit to add or adjust some cables, I do advise to connect all the cables that you need before you hang the TV. And when it comes to connections, you get the usual four HDMI 2.1 ports, so all of them can run 4K 120. There's a LAN connection, some USB ports, an optical out, a headphone jack, and of course, there's the usual antenna and tuner ports for anyone that still watches traditional TV. And just like on the G10, the power cord is not that long and it is fixed to the TV, so keep that in mind. Now, the way OLED works is that instead of having one big backlight lighting the whole panel, like a usual TV would have. On an OLED TV, each individual pixel is its own light source. Now that means that each pixel can go very bright and each pixel can turn off completely when displaying black. So it's full local dimming per pixel, resulting in perfect black levels, infinite contrast, and no blooming like we've seen on some mini LED monitors. Now, compared to a traditional TV or a VA monitor, which are known to have a relatively good contrast, OLED TVs are on a completely different level. Now, another big strength of an OLED TV are the colors. It can cover most of the DCI-P3 color space, which means it can basically show any color of any actual content you want to see in HDR and SDR. Colors just look alive and vibrant, and color accuracy out of the box is good as well, resulting in a natural looking image even if you don't change any of the default settings. It really doesn't matter what you do with your TV, from movies and series to cartoons, cooking shows and documentaries, everything just looks fantastic on an OLED TV, and it just puts regular TVs to shame, even QLED. But it is also a very capable gaming panel, actually. So this G1 has a 120Hz refresh rate, near instant pixel response times, support for G-Sync and FreeSync, and very little lag in game mode, which turns on automatically whenever you connect a gaming console or a PC. Now, as you can see, I managed to get my hands on a PlayStation 5, and I have to say that 120Hz gaming is definitely a step up for consoles, because you can definitely feel the difference. And as far as PC gaming goes, it's actually a very good experience as well. G-Sync support isn't perfect quite yet, and there is a possibility of occasional flickering in some lower FPS, lower brightness situations, but it is not something that I personally noticed. I just read about it, and LG did say that the VRR is not completely perfect, but I still do think it is a very good step up compared to previous models. Now, the total latency, so the combination of the TV's input lag and pixel response time while using the same test rig I use for all my monitor testing, is actually a couple of milliseconds behind a few high-end PC gaming monitors I tested so far. Just make sure that your input lag setting is set to boost mode, because it actually makes quite a difference. Gaming feels really smooth, and it is definitely a completely different experience, but still, a PC gaming monitor will give you a slight competitive advantage. If I compare the total latency to the G10 from last year, it's a bit faster, but if I compare it to the 2017 C7, there is a huge difference between the two. If you have a much older OLED panel and you're very serious about gaming on a TV, upgrading would not be a terrible idea. But should you buy a new TV if you already have the G10? Now, the key difference in this new OLED Evo or OLED 2.0 panel is that they added a new layer, and that the material that emits the light is stronger than before, which means that this panel right here should go brighter than its predecessor while using less power. And that difference is definitely measurable. My G10 topped out at 750 nits, while this G1 goes up to around 840 nits in small areas. There's a significant improvement with a white zone filling 25% of the screen, going from 430 to around 500 nits. And when displaying a full screen of white, at which point the power limit really comes into play, there's a significant improvement from around 140 nits to almost 200. So it will be able to show HDR content specifically brighter than before. It does that while using less power as well, around 10 to 20 watts less, so you won't notice that in your energy bill at the end of the year, unless you watch TV all the time. But the fact that each cell uses less power means that the risk of burn-in should be reduced, which is still, you know, one of the main concerns with OLED TVs. I personally haven't seen any burn-in on my C7 after years of using it, nor on my G10 after 1 year. And I still believe that as long as you are very reasonable and you don't watch the same channel every single night or just play one game with the same UI every day, it's not something you should really worry about. but it is still an existing serious issue that can happen, so it is very important to just, you know, avoid those things. And that is also one of the reasons I still wouldn't recommend this as a primary PC monitor where you have the same desktop elements showing all of the time. Now, it also kind of takes away from the gallery mode they added, that's right behind me, which is supposed to make your TV look, you know, like a fancy painting on the wall. But to avoid the burn-in, the images just rotate really fast, and instead of giving you a calm artistic form on your wall, it just looks busy. Now, I would suggest you just pretend that feature doesn't exist and, you know, just move on. Another well-known consideration is the fact that OLED panels are pretty reflective. Now, these new models are a bit better than the old ones, but they are still very reflective. Now, that does help with the colors and the HDR experience usually, but it can be very distracting when you're in a bright room with lots of lights behind you, just staring at yourself and not really seeing what's going on the TV. Now, I don't really think that's a reason not to get an OLED TV, but I do think that is definitely a good reminder to get some proper curtains when you do. Now, the new G1 also has a new A9 Gen 4 processor, which adds a bunch of features to improve both the picture and the sound quality. There's also several presets you can work with. You can fine-tune any of those in terms of brightness, contrast, colors, and so on. And then there are also the AI modes, which are meant to just automatically improve the content you watch. I want to say it's best to just experiment and just figure out what you like best, because there's definitely enough of presets for you to find one that suits you. For me personally, it goes between the standard and the cinema home mode. So the standard mode is a bit more colder and crisp, and it is fine for most regular TV programs, while the cinema home mode is a bit warmer, adds a lot of atmosphere, and it is definitely my preferred setting for movies and series. The expert Brightspace mode is ideal for PC users, as that one showed the best color performance out of the box. And of course, if you want to game, you should use the game mode, as there is a huge difference in speed if you're in other modes. LG also changed the shape of their remote controls this time around. The size is pretty much the same, but the new shape does feel more balanced while holding it. They added more buttons to include Disney Plus, for example, but I would say everything else is pretty much the same. You can wave it around to use it as a cursor. It features a microphone, so you can actually talk to your TV if you're feeling particularly lazy that day, or, you know, you can just use the arrows and a scroll wheel like a normal person would do. But the only thing that I'm not really happy about is the new menu and a lot of things that come with it. So on previous models, the home screen would just be a long bar at the bottom, showing all your applications and letting you choose one. And if you were watching already something and you click that home button, the bar would just appear over whatever you were watching. While the new menu is just a full screen application that tries to push all the current trending content to you. Now, I do suppose that for a mainstream audience, this might seem like a good step, as it will be more familiar and simpler because it kind of looks like a Netflix menu, but I personally do have quite a few issues with it. First of all, you need to make an LG account and you need to allow LG to collect your data to even show anything in the top half of the menu. If you don't, it will just have this huge constant reminder that the top half would be available if you just accept their terms, which is super annoying. But once you log in, you will find that most of the home screen cannot be changed at all, and you will have all these suggestions forced on you, and not just for platforms you have a subscription for, which is fine, I kind of do like tips on what to watch every once in a while, but it is also advertising platforms I don't have installed or I've never even heard of. But my kind of main and the most serious issue here is that the suggestions are not always kid-friendly, and I have a 5-year-old and an 8-year-old that do watch TV and know how to turn it on and to pick a cartoon or a kid's show by themselves. And even though all my streaming services do have kids' profiles and are logged in for the kids, some of the recommendations are definitely not kid-friendly. So it's happily recommending some cartoons, which is great, But at the same time, it is forcing some sponsor suggestions, and they're even forcing some reality trash TV that I would never consider watching, and I definitely don't want my kids to know it exists. I mean, just because it's trending doesn't make it okay for my kids to accidentally click on X on the Beach, Double Dutch, or something like that. It's just wrong, and I think they should consider the fact that most households have children that do watch TV, and the fact that you cannot easily get around this is a huge miss from LG, in my opinion. The only alternative is to log out again and just settle for that constant reminder, asking you to accept the terms and conditions repeatedly, which is definitely a downgrade in experience compared to their previous models, in my honest opinion. Other than that rant, navigating the OS is a pretty smooth experience. The interface is fast, it's easy to add some of your own apps, and if you ignore the useless top half of the main menu, the application slider in the bottom is still pretty much the same as before, letting you switch between your preferred services, regular TV, or your consoles. Considering how thin this TV is, it's pretty impressive how good it sounds. I mean, it's not going to beat a proper audio system, but for anyone that is used to just having a TV sound, this will be an upgrade. Now, perhaps the biggest positive change this year is the pricing, and that is something that we don't hear often enough. So the last year's model, the 65-inch G10, launched at $3,500, while the brand new G1 launches at $3,000 in the US. Well, here in the EU, the situation is even better. A 65-inch G10 would have cost you 3,600 euros a year ago, and the G1 now is standing at 2,650 euros, so that's almost 1,000 euros less. And keep in mind, LG TV prices always drop throughout the year, so if you decide to wait a bit longer, chances are that the price will be even lower. This also puts the G1 in a better spot compared to the C1, which currently costs 2,400 euros here in the Netherlands, which is only 250 euros less than the G1, and it doesn't have the new Evo OLED panel. So last year I had some doubts, as the C10 and the G10 used the same panel and had a 500 euro price gap just for the design alone. Well, this year I can safely say that the G1 is easily worth it over the C1. So to conclude, I already considered the G10 to be one of the very best TVs you could get last year, and this year, LG comes out with an even brighter panel that uses less power and launches with a considerably lower price. So yeah, I do think they mostly made the right choices with the G1. Let's say it like that. I even think their Evo marketing was not even that much over the top. I mean, calling it OLED 2.0 is a bit of a stretch, but the improvements are measurable and they're even visible. I really do dislike the main menu, I have to say, and it kind of stings a bit because the rest of the TV is just done so right. So I really do hope they take this criticism seriously and tweak it a bit so it's more family friendly. And I'm pretty sure that a nice software update would be enough to sort all that out. Anyway, that's it for me for today. I really hope you enjoyed this review. If you did, please subscribe to this channel to never miss an upload. Bye guys, and see you in the next one. Bye.